Daniel chapter 9. So over the last couple of weeks, we've embarked upon, really before that, we started a series where we were talking about the Jewish wedding. And what we were trying to do was we were trying to connect the Jewish wedding and the way the betrothal of the Jewish wedding, which is similar to our Western thought of engagement. And we talked about the fact that Jesus as the bridegroom, which is another name for the groom, comes just like the bridegroom in the Jewish wedding feast, comes to the bride's house, amen, and he offers a wedding contract to the bride. And Jesus became flesh, amen, the incarnate Son of God became flesh, came to the bride's home, which is our earth, this fallen earth, and he offered a contract, amen, the word of God, and a purchase price, the giving of his life to pay the penalty of our sin. In the Jewish wedding, what ends up happening at that point in time is that begins the betrothal process. Once the bridegroom comes to the bride, he offers marriage, and they agree upon it, and the purchase price is paid, and it's agreed upon, that begins the betrothal process, kind of like an engagement period, where the two of them are separated. It says that the bridegroom would go home to the Father's house, and like we've talked many times, Jesus said in John chapter 14, he told Philip, I'm going in my Father's house, there's many mansions, I'm going away to prepare a place for you. He said, I'm coming back again, and if it wasn't so, then I wouldn't tell you that. And so Jesus is going on a journey, and just as the bride in the Jewish wedding feast would await like the parable of the 10 virgins for the return of the bridegroom, you and I, if we truly are believers, amen, have given our life to Christ, and now we're in this betrothal process, and the concept in the Jewish word had to do with separation. We're being separated out. Did you know that you're a separated one? Amen. As a matter of fact, you know what? This is a good time just to go ahead and write something on the board. You know, the word church, the word church, literally in the Greek, this is how you spell it, ecclesia, okay? And just to make a point here, ek means out, and ecclesia means called. So really and truly, the church is supposed to be the called out ones. I just want to make that point to you, in case you were new and you accidentally turned into this parking lot and you meant to go into another parking lot. I need you to know that the church is supposed to be the called out ones. That means that we're not supposed to look like the world. We're not. We're not supposed to have an entertainment show going on like the world does. Amen? No, we're supposed to be separated out. We're supposed to be called out. Another word that is used in the Greek for the word chosen is actually eklektos. And that means out and chosen. Amen? So out and chosen. Amen? Eklektos. So listen, it's an out thing. Amen? Out of what? Well, when you were born like your father Adam, you were born into the world. Amen. God sent Jesus, the darling of heaven, sent him from heaven to the earth. He was manifest in the flesh. Why was he manifest in the flesh? Don't get tired of me if you come to church here. He was manifest in the flesh because Hebrews 2:14 says, because the children were partakers of flesh and blood, he became the same. He became a man, amen, a sinless man, so that he could offer up his sinless life on the cross to pay the penalty of sin, because the wages of sin is death. And he offered up that sinless life like Adam was originally molded and created. Amen, you knew that, right? Adam was created without sin in the image and likeness of God. Amen. And then when he took sin into him, it spread through the entirety of the human race. And so Jesus, the sinless one, came from heaven to earth. This is all going to fit into what we're talking about. The Spirit of God, the eternal Word, the third person of the second person of the Trinity, if you will, the eternal Word that spoke the worlds into existence, became flesh, dwelt upon the earth, offered his life as a sinless sacrifice in your stead. And when you placed your faith in that, you place your faith in that, then a miracle happened in your heart. Yes. Let me tell you how you know whether you're saved. I know I tell the people this a lot, but let me go ahead and tell you again. Not because you raised your hand in church one time. No. Not because you went to vacation Bible school one time and raised your hand. No. Not because your mom and your daddy told you that you needed to get saved. No. Because you believed with your heart and you confessed with your mouth. It's not just intellectual understanding. You understand that? Yeah. The Word of God says in the book of James, you believe there's one God, you do well. The devils also believe, yet they tremble. Intellectually, you can believe and understand that, you know what, 2,000 years ago, a 33-year-old Jew died on two pieces of wood outside a city called Jerusalem. And you can understand that intellectually, but if you've never given your heart to it, then the miracle of being born again did not take place in your heart. You missed heaven by 12 inches. You knew it. You believed it here. intellectually, but you never let it sink here. You never, because see, when you believe with your heart, that's talking about your inner man, your spirit man. Believing with your heart, confessing with your mouth. And when you do that, you're not perfect. Come on, somebody. There was only one perfect one. Man. Don't look at the preacher thinking he's perfect because he ain't perfect. But what I will tell you is this. When you get born again, a miracle does happen. The Holy Spirit comes and He deposits Himself on the inside of your life, and things start to change. The book of Ephesians 1:13 says that you have received a down payment. Amen. You received an earnest of your inheritance. What does that mean? When you got saved, the Holy Ghost came to live on the inside of you, and He's telling you and He's sealing you with the Holy Spirit. He's letting you know things are different now, child. Things are different now. You're a called out one. You're a chosen out one. And you can't just live your life anymore the way that you used to live your life. Amen?
Amen.
Word of God says that you've been bought with a price. You've been purchased with a price. You're His bride. Amen? So that's where we started. And what we did was, because see, the Jewish wedding feast, oftentimes there's archaeology. There's even biblical passages that talk about that. Samson and his wedding feast, it was 7 days. And there's other spots. Jacob worked for 7 years. And then her, whenever he had to do his week for Leah, it was a week. It was a 7-day period. And so there, that concept of seven is in there. And so we started off the thought process of the Great Tribulation by talking about that. That it coincides, the Jewish wedding, the scriptures throughout all of the parables that have to do with a wedding and the thought of God marrying and providing a bride for Himself. I'm not saying that it makes it definitive. The point that I'm trying to make is that it makes some sense. The number seven in a 7-year possibility of a tribulation at the end. Now, some people will say, well, why do you want to say possibility? We're trying to come to the book with a fresh viewpoint. All right, now, so this is where we were with that. And then in Daniel chapter 9, I warned the people. Some people have come in later. We've taught this for 2 weeks. This is not an easy passage of scripture. If you want to watch it on YouTube, you can. All I'm going to do is read it and make a couple of points, and then we're moving on, because this isn't even really what we're talking about tonight, okay? But I want to review it. Daniel chapter 9, verse 24. 70 weeks are determined upon your people and upon the holy city to finish the transgression and to make an end of sins. Now, what did we say about the 70 weeks? We said that the 70 weeks really represented 70 weeks represented 70 years times 7, all right? And what you come up with whenever you do that math is 490 years. And it says, so 70 weeks, or if we're going to just go ahead and translate it to what it means, 490 years are determined upon your people. Whose people? Daniel's people. This is Daniel praying and asking God to show up and give him revelation after the children of Israel have been in captivity. You didn't know that, by the way, didn't you? If you're a child of God and you open up the door and you mess around with sin too long, the Lord does have a way of allowing you to find yourself under the captivity of your enemy, and then you can't just get out quite as easily as what you thought you were going to get out.
Mm-hmm.
The Lord knows how to teach His people some things.
Amen.
Amen? It goes on to say right here that these 70 weeks or 490 years are determined upon your people and upon the holy city, which is Jerusalem. To finish some things. The transgression, we're not going to get into all that. To make an end of sins, to make reconciliation for iniquity, and to bring in everlasting righteousness. Much of this has to do with, in the end, and regarding the millennial reign of Christ, okay? And so it goes on to say, and to seal up the vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem unto Messiah the Prince. So two things that we were told here. Number one, from the going forth of the commandment to restore and rebuild Jerusalem. You remember what we said in the book of Nehemiah? What happened in the book of Nehemiah was that the king told Nehemiah that he could go back and build the walls to the city. And scholars say that that happened in 444 B.C., and that started a prophetic time clock, is what we said. As soon as that edict went forth, see, Daniel prophesied it before it happened. Gabriel told Daniel it was going to happen. And then once that happened, whenever that king said it, a prophetic time clock was started. And then the next thing that we were waiting for was unto the time of Messiah the Prince shall be 7 weeks. Okay, and 62 weeks. So 60 is 60 weeks, because 20, so 60, 20. and 20 is 60, plus 2, 62, plus 7 is 69. All right? So a 69-week period, which is actually 483 years, whenever Messiah the Prince shows up. Now, who's that? Messiah the Prince. We're actually going to talk about the word Messiah tonight.
Jesus.
Amen. It's Jesus. The word Messiah means anointed. Okay, we're going to talk about that in a second. As a matter of fact, that's the emphasis of my message tonight. And so what happened was that whenever the king gave the decree, and you do the math according to the difference between the Hebrew calendar and the Gregorian calendar that we use now, it comes out, scholars say, to 483 years on a specific day, whenever Jesus showed up for the triumphant entry. Remember, that was the one time, really and truly, that, well, not maybe the one time, but that was the main time that Jesus did not tell the people to stop calling him king. Remember that? Or recognize him as king. Oh, son of David, have mercy on us. Throwing palm branches on the ground, amen. Worshiping, Hosanna in the highest, oh, son of David. And salvation, they want him to bring them salvation, but the reality of it is that Jesus told him, your eyes are hidden because you missed the day of your visitation. What are you talking about, Jesus? We're over here throwing palm branches on the ground. We're welcoming you as the seed of David. We're welcoming you as the anointed one, the one that was promised, the king of Israel, that would show up and deliver us. That's the problem. You're looking for deliverance from this world right here and the captivity that you're in under Rome. I've come to deliver you from your sin. You missed the day of your visitation. But what happened was that the decree was given. A 483-year period happened. Messiah showed up. Jesus died on the cross, amen, resurrected from the dead. And on 50 days after he resurrected, the Holy Spirit descended, hallelujah, descended on the day of Pentecost, and the church was birthed. But even before that, the day after he showed up on the triumphant entry, on that day, the next day, he showed up, what was he riding? He was riding a colt of a donkey, right? And I'm being specific because there's a reason. He was riding a colt of a donkey because there was a donkey also. Remember, he told him to go and lose both of them. Right. So there was a mother donkey and a colt donkey. Jesus is riding the colt. The mother's empty. Mm-hmm. The mother represents Israel, who gives birth to the colt, which is the church, through Jesus. Amen. Now that he's riding the colt because there's a new vehicle now that he's going to move and touch humanity through. And it's the church. Amen. Hallelujah. You're part of that. But the donkey's empty. It doesn't mean God's done with Israel, but what it means is now there's a period of time God's not moving through Israel. And the next day, he showed up on Fig Tree Monday and he cursed the fig tree because it bore no fruit, just like Israel was bearing no fruit. And now there's been a period of time known as the church age. All right? There's a period of time known as the church age. That's where you and I are right now. This is the betrothal. We're married to Jesus. Amen? Yeah. And we're in the midst of this separating out thing where we're not supposed to look like the world. I didn't say perfect. Jesus is the perfect one. But I'm talking about learning how to walk in covenant with God. Faith in Jesus Christ and what he did for you at the cross that gives you grace, strengthens you, empowers you, and gives you the power that you need in order to not cross the wrong line and go the wrong way and do the wrong thing. Amen? He wants to give you the power that you need to live for Jesus. And so here we are in the midst of the church age. Now, at some point in time, the Word of God talks about rapture, right? And it also talks about a seven-year tribulation. At least that's what we're looking at here. Because listen, what I want to tell you is that whenever you look at this, you add 7 years to this 483, you come up with your 490. So what I'm telling you is there's a seven-year period missing. Does that make sense? I know this is a lot of math and maybe a little bit confusing, but if you haven't been here, but whenever the edict went forth to Jesus showed up was 483 years, the total prophecy was 490 years, there's a seven-year period missing, a seven-year period for Daniel's people, which is Israel. Do you know that God uses tribulation in your life to get your attention? Did you know that? If you hadn't figured it out yet, let me give you a news flash. God will use tribulation in your life to get your attention. Amen? Amen. Just as he uses tribulation in your life to get your attention, he's going to use the great tribulation in Israel's life to get their attention. There's coming a day whenever the Word of God says in Zechariah chapter 12, on that day I'm going to pour out my spirit of grace and supplication on the inhabitants of Jerusalem. And he says, they're going to look at me whom they pierced, and they're going to mourn for me as one who mourns for an only son.
Yeah.
God has been using trial and tribulation, and he's going to use the great tribulation in Israel's life to get a hold of them. So the majority of the great tribulation really is really mostly all about Israel. At some point in time, I'm going to show you where I think that maybe I'm kind of looking at a pre-wrath rapture. Okay, whenever, and I'm going to tell you why whenever we get to it. Let's not get too caught up in it right now. But why would God allow the church to go? Paul said he has not appointed us unto wrath. That's exactly right. But it doesn't mean that he hasn't appointed us to get shaken up a little bit, to wake us up a little bit. Whenever we're in the midst of a modern church and the preacher won't even tell the truth because he's scared that he's going to offend people and that they might not come back next week. Lord, help us. How can we water down the eternal word of God? How can we water down what God has written through man and put it on papyrus for man to read? It's not man's job to put his fingers all up in it and to mess it up.
Amen.
The man of God is supposed to preach the word of God.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
So what I'm trying to say is that God's merciful.
That's right.
I see God allowing some shaking to happen because he's merciful.
Amen.
To wake people up.
That's right.
Amen. To get a hold of them, to get their attention. He loves us. He doesn't want to leave us in the midst of a mess. Amen? And even if it's not a pre-wrath and it's really truly a pre-tribulation rapture, I was telling somebody a while back, you go preach that stuff in Syria right now.
Yeah.
Wasn't that long ago, people were putting pictures on Facebook of people getting crucified over there. They putting children in cages and lighting them on fire. The other day they put them in cages, and according to what Danielle was telling me, they threw them in a lake or a swimming pool or something like that, made them drown in the swimming pool. And you think cutting limbs off. I know you didn't come here to hear that kind of preaching, but would you want me not to tell you the truth? In Syria right now, you're going to have a hard time convincing them that they're not in the midst of the Great Tribulation. You understand what I'm trying to say? In America, we've gotten soft. We've gotten soft, man. And I'm telling you right now, the first thing that hits our soil and starts shaking things up, people are going to start questioning the validity of the Bible because all they've ever been taught, and with their American mindset, they thought everything was just going to be smooth sailing like butter, baby, and that everything's going to be good until that day we all float off in the sky. I'm here to tell you, Jesus wasn't an American. Come on. God was in covenant with the Jewish nation, and through the Jewish nation, he gave us Jesus. Hallelujah. And we're supposed to be in covenant with Jesus.
Amen.
I'm not trying to be a prophet of doom. I'm trying to wake us up and make us aware there's some crazy things going on in the midst of this world right now.
Amen.
All right. So it goes on to say right here that in verse 26, that after a certain amount of time that Messiah would be cut off. Literally, that wording in the original language, cut off, talks about the sectioning up of a covenant animal. That's interesting. It's surprising to me that the Jewish people didn't realize that. You know, whenever God would cut covenant, and I got to hustle up. When God would cut covenant or have people cut covenant, the animal would be cut and they would put the carcass, two pieces of the carcass, like in the whenever God cut covenant with Abraham, I think it was Genesis 15, and they would walk through it. This is the same terminology used of Messiah, that he would be cut off, that he would be, it's like a slain animal. And yet they still missed it. They still missed the fact that Messiah ended up dying. See, they weren't looking for that once again. But it says he would be cut off, not for himself. In other words, he didn't die for his own sin. He died for yours, and he died for mine because he had no sin. Amen?
Amen?
Then it says right here, a big transition takes place. I want you to see that after that colon in verse 26. And the people of the prince that shall come. You see, we've completely changed to a whole different person. We were talking about Messiah the prince. Now we're talking about a prince that will come. And this prince, it says right here, the people of the prince that shall come will destroy the city and the sanctuary. Now I want you to know, I don't have time to go back to it, but we talked about it last week. We proved that this is the Roman Empire. All right? We proved it through prophetic scripture in the book of Revelation and the book of Daniel. And so what ends up happening here is that in AD 70... there was a general named Titus of the Roman army, and you know what he did? He destroyed the sanctuary and he destroyed the temple. And it says right here, the people of the prince that shall come. So what I need you to understand is, and I know that this is a little bit confusing, but I'm going to try to slow down a little bit for the people that weren't here last week, is that there's a seven-headed beast in the book of Revelation chapter 17. And it represents seven nations that have been in existence that had held Israel in bondage. Egypt, Assyria, Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, Rome, number six. Number seven is the ten-horned kingdom that comes from the revitalized Roman Empire. Daniel tells us that. Number eight comes from the number seven. That's the empire of the Antichrist. All right. So what I want you to see is that there's these kingdoms that are going on. But what happens is that the people of this prince that is to come is the Roman people or the Roman Empire that showed up in AD 70. But the prince of these people, he doesn't come until over here, because that prince is the Antichrist. Does that make sense? What I'm trying to tell you, that in the Daniel prophecy, it talked about Rome having iron teeth and stomping out the residue of all the other nations that were before it. But it also said that it had 10 horns. All right. And we don't hear about the 10 horns again until we get to the book of Revelation at the end. And the 10 horns are one of the heads of the seven-headed beast. The seven-headed beast, what I'm trying to tell you, see, there's not a whole lot of people going around talking about this. I wrote a book and the Lord showed me this. The beast is really a system, and it's important that I try to explain this to you. The beast is really a system. It says in the book of Revelation, chapter 17, that it represents seven kings. It's representing kings and kingdoms. You understand that the liar, Satan, has been on this earth, and the spirit of Antichrist has been moving. We're going to see some stuff today. I'm going to hurry up. We're going to get done in time. We're going to see some stuff today. I want to show you some things. The spirit of Antichrist is so deceitful that we in the church think we got something figured out, and the whole time our eyes have been blinded to what's really going on. The Word of God says in Revelation, as a matter of fact, let's turn to Revelation 17. Yes, sir. Revelation 17. Let's just start reading. Revelation chapter 17, starting in verse 1. And there came one of the seven angels which had seven vials and talked with me, saying unto me, Come here, I will show unto thee the judgment of the great whore that sits upon many waters, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication. Many waters means land masses that jut out of the waters in which people live upon. And so it says, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication. You see that? Now, if you don't stop and think about that, you got to be a thinker whenever you, amen, when we read the Bible, we all need to be thinkers. The kings of the earth, what is that talking about? That's talking about rulers. That's talking about leaders. That's talking about people that have been in high places. That's talking about people in the past. That's talking about people at the time that John was writing. And it's talking about people today. Newsflash. All politicians can't be trusted. All governments can't be trusted. You pick and choose which ones you think are corrupt. And I know in my head which ones I think are corrupt. What I'm trying to tell you is you can't trust anybody. There's a spirit upon the earth that's moving and operating in the midst of humanity. The Word of God says in Psalm chapter 2, why do the heathen rage? Why do the people imagine a vain thing? The kings of the earth set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together, and they say, let us break their bands from us, and let us cut their cords asunder, and they speak this to the Lord and to His anointed. That means that the kings of the earth and the rulers are in union with one another, coming against God Himself, coming against His anointed one. We're going to talk about the anointed one tonight. In other words, the kings of the earth, for the annals of human history, have bought in with Satan because he's offered them power, he's offered them prestige, he's offered them money, he's offered them riches. He offers them whatever it is that they want. Jesus called him the prince of this world three different times. He has power upon this earth. And the only way that you can have power that's greater than His is to have Jesus living on the inside of you, because the Word of God says that He that is in us is greater than he that is in the world. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So I want you to know the kings of the earth have committed fornication, verse 2, and the inhabitants of the earth, that's you and me, the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. I said this last week, but I've said it many times, but I'll say it again. Have you ever been drunk? I'm not proud of it, but I've been drunk many times. One of the things that I learned whenever you're drunk, or if any kind of a chemical that changes the chemistry of your brain to the point where you can't think right, you understand what I'm talking about. You just walk around like you don't even know what you're doing anymore, man. You can't see right. You can't hear right. You can't make right judgments. You hear what somebody's telling you and it goes in, it's filtered completely different, and something comes out of your mouth and you're like, did I say that? Oh man, I wish I wouldn't have said that. The point is that the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. She's a harlot. And I'm going to tell you right now, the harlot represents false religion. Pick your flavor. I'm talking about churches in this community that don't preach the gospel right. False religion. It's a false doctrine. It doesn't matter whether they do it on purpose or on accident. The result is the same. God's people are left in bondage instead of given freedom and liberty. It talks about Buddhism. It talks about Sufism, which is a mystical form of Islam. It's talking about all the mystery religions that have ever existed. And you're going to see some of it right here on this video in a little bit. It's everywhere. The prince of the power of the air, he doesn't quit. He's relentless. He wants to destroy everything that you know. He wants to destroy God's people. He's already causing the whole world to go the way of his way. He wants to get a hold of Jesus' bride. There's only one way that you can ruin a wedding. That's the fastest way to ruin a wedding is to insert a harlot into the midst of a marriage. And that's what he is. That's what she is. False religion. Inserting herself into the midst of this marriage. Trying to ruin the relationship that God desires to have with humanity, pulling people away from Jesus. Goes on to say, verse 3, so he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast. There's the beast. Full of names of blasphemy, having 7 heads and 10 horns. There's those horns I was telling you about. 7 heads. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand, full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. Last week I told you to Google. Oh, I'm going to say it because I'm about to show you a video anyway. I told you to Google the Vatican and to Google the priests and the cardinals and how they look whenever they're dressed, scarlet and purple. I told you to also look at, consider, I'm not trying to say that this is the Catholic Church. The Catholic Church is, and most people in the Catholic Church don't even know this. I was born and raised Catholic. I was a good little Catholic. Well, I wasn't a good little Catholic boy, but I was Catholic. But my point is that just because you're Catholic, then I remember I told y'all that a while back. My friend said, I'll see you in hell, fat boy. I said, I ain't going to hell. Well, why did I think I was going to hell? Because I was Catholic. I had never given my heart to Jesus. I had never really been sealed with the Spirit of God. No, really, maybe I had. But my point is that I thought it was because I was Catholic. Is why I was going. We'll talk more about that in a second. See, that's one thing that they would, that's a major faux pas what I just did right there. I just told you what I believe to be the truth. And I said it in such a way, somebody in here might be Catholic. I wasn't supposed to do that. No, I was. I was supposed to tell you. I'm going to show you some more stuff here in a second. It goes on to say, verse 5, and upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. What I want you to see is that I'm not saying this is the Catholic Church. I'm saying the Catholic Church is part of it. And that the whole mystery religions, every false doctrine, every false thing that has thrown people off the right pathway towards Jesus is part of this harlot who is causing the inhabitants of the earth to be made drunk with the wine of her fornication. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
We can't see right. All right? And verse 6, and I saw the woman drunk with the blood of the saints, and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus, and when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration. That word there, it doesn't mean he admired this thing. It means that he was amazed, and it was almost like he was perplexed. An angel said unto me, why did you marvel? I will tell you the mystery of the woman and of the beast that carries her, which has the 7 heads and 10 horns. The beast that you saw was and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit and go into perdition. And they that dwell on the earth shall wonder. Pay attention to that. I don't know if I'll get back to it, but this hit me today. The beast will ascend out of the bottomless pit. Mm-hmm. All right. There's a lot of different interpretations of that. But what I want you to know is this. Ultimately, this beast, it turns into a man. And it's the Antichrist. And one of the things that the Lord showed me today was this. Was that Jesus, the Christ, descended, amen, the spirit of the Christ became flesh. He came from heaven to earth. And the spirit of this Antichrist is going to come from inside the earth and come upon the earth. And he goes on to say, wonder whose names were not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, when they behold the beast that was and is not and yet is. And here's the mind which has wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sits. I also told you last week to Google Rome and the seven hills of Rome. That Rome is built on seven hills. This is well known, well documented. It's all over the place. We just don't know it because nobody wants to tell us about it. And here's the mind which has wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sits. Verse 10, and there are seven kings. Five are fallen, one is, and the other is not yet come. And when he comes, he must continue a short space. And the beast that was and is not, even he is the eighth, and he is of the seven, and goes into perdition. What does that mean? I believe that number seven is a ten-horned empire that's going to be the revitalized Roman Empire, and that the number eight is actually the kingdom of the Antichrist that came from number seven. That's what that says right there. I know that's a lot of information. Don't listen. Sometimes we got to hear stuff for the first time. Take some notes. Rewatch the video. All right? And the ten horns which you saw are ten kings, which have received no kingdom as of yet, but receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. These have one mind and shall give their power and strength unto the beast. So I want you to understand that ultimately the beast, the way I'm seeing it, is this seven-headed monster that has existed through the annals of human history. The way I wrote it in my fictional story, in my book, was that somebody had a vision. It was a dream. He woke up screaming, and it was like, because what he saw was this beast, and he was galloping through the annals of human history. 2000 BC, 1500 BC. See, he's galloping. And he's got seven heads, and these heads are going all around, and they're just grabbing up people, and they're crunching bone, and they're eating flesh, and they're just blood's flying everywhere. But the beast is government leaders that have been duped, if you will, by Satan. And along with this harlot that's riding it, she's over here getting drunk with the martyr's blood. She is false religion, and the two of them have been working in unison. Does this make sense, what I'm trying to tell you? Corrupt governments led by demonic leaders that have been influenced by Satan himself as the beast, and false religion is riding its back, and they're moving through the annals of human history, and they're taking over nations, and it's all being done behind the scenes where the naked eye can't really see what's going on. Why? Because the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine over fornication. What I'm trying to tell you is this is what's been going on through the years. Amen. From the beginning, even in the garden, whenever the serpent said, in the day that you eat thereof, you will not die, but instead you will know. Bing. Your eyes will be open. That's what the word Illuminati means. Y'all knew that, right? I've told y'all that. Illuminati, illumination, if you hadn't heard of Illuminati. And it's a form of another knowledge. It's a form of another wisdom. It doesn't come from God. It comes from the liar. They call him the light bearer. We're going to get into him a little bit tonight. And so what I want you to see, though, is that this beast, originally, it's this seven-headed government situation. But ultimately, the beast will also become a man. And there's scripture we're going to look at. The beast is given eyes and a mouth to speak. The beast has wisdom. The beast knows riddles. He knows how to speak in such a way that he tells you one thing and you think you're hearing something, but in reality, everything he's telling you is a lie, is deceit, is fraud, but yet you buy into it because he speaks eloquently, he speaks with wisdom, and there's a demonic anointing behind what it is that he's saying, and he mesmerizes. He mesmerizes the crowd and everybody. The same spirit that will cause people to vote for somebody that doesn't even make sense because he mesmerizes. Same spirit seduces them. Same thing that Hitler did. Same spirit seduces people. All right? All right, Daniel 9. We're back to Daniel 9 now. I wanted to talk to you about government situation, what the beast was with the seven heads. I think that I halfway explained that. And now we're talking about that prince. And it says that, and the people of the prince, that's the Roman Empire, Titus, General Titus, verse 26, part B. The people of the prince, the Roman Empire, AD 70, shall come, the prince is the Antichrist, he'll be later. They shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof will be with a flood. Let's look at verse 27. And he, remember I told y'all last week I got into a big old knockdown drag out with a Jehovah Witness elder over this. It says right here in verse 27, It says he. Well, what is that pronoun connected to? Pronouns have what you call an antecedent. That means that it has to be connected to the last noun, right? That it was talking about, right? And what was the last noun? The prince of the people that shall come. So this pronoun he is connected to that prince of the people that shall come. He shall confirm a covenant with many for 1 week. This is that last week that we were talking about. The 7-year tribulation. So what I want you to see is this. The way I see it, this is a review, that the real spark that starts the last 7 years is not so much the rapture of the church. I mean, it could be. They could happen synonymously. But in reality, it's this right here. It's the signing of this covenant. Mm-hmm. It says he will confirm a covenant, or if it's a covenant, some people say it's already been signed. And that all now it just has to be confirmed. All right? I've read some information that seems pretty legit that some of this could have already happened. And so he confirms the covenant with many for a week, that last 7-year period. But in the middle of it, he breaks the covenant. This is talking about the Antichrist. All right. So that was Daniel chapter 9. But now I want to go to 1 John. And I want to talk to you about the Antichrist, because that's how that door was opened. We got to him who was going to confirm this covenant with the people of Israel. Because remember, the prophecy was for Daniel's people, which is the nation of Israel. And now we're in 1 John chapter 2. And we're going to start in verse 18. And I want to try to talk to you a little bit about the concept of Christ and Antichrist. All right. So it says right here, 1 John chapter 2, verse 18. This is John as he's nearing the end. Amen. Some people say he would have been, this is supposed to be like around AD 90 that he wrote this. He's the last of the surviving apostles. And he says, little children, it is the last time. And as you have heard that Antichrist shall come, even now are there many Antichrists, whereby we know that it is the last time. First thing I wanted you to see was that the Bible talks about many Antichrists. Number one, many. All right, next week we're going to talk about various people in the scriptures that represent types of the Antichrist. Whether it be Nimrod, whether it be Nebuchadnezzar, whether it be Judas Iscariot, various people who have been types of the Antichrist through the ages. Hitler was a type of Antichrist. People that want to oppress God's people, they want to destroy God's people, and the enemy uses them as a vessel or a vehicle through which he desires to destroy God's people. And we can learn various things through their lives. So there's many Antichrists. But look what he says. He says, as you have heard, Antichrist shall come. So he's saying that there will be an Antichrist, but even now, there are many. So I just wanted you to know that there have been many. And look at this, verse 22. It says, who is a liar but he that denies that Jesus is the Christ? Now, I got to make a big deal about this. Is the Christ. Now, I'm not trying to be elementary, but this is real important that we get this. Christ is not Jesus' last name. Christ is a title. We're about to talk about it in a second. I want you to get that. Christ is a title, and it means anointed one. What I want you to understand is that there's a whole slew of people on this earth that are waiting for somebody else to show up as the Christ. And it's not Jesus. You understand what I'm saying? And listen, they're not blind. See, most of the church is blind to a lot of this stuff we're talking about. These people aren't blind. These people want this other person to show up because they think that they're going to win. You understand what I'm getting at? I need you to understand that. So it says that the spirit of Antichrist, or it says this is the liar, he that denies that Jesus is the Christ. All right? And it goes on to say right here in 1 John chapter 4. So there's many Antichrists. And now this verse here talks about the spirit of Antichrist. In 1 John chapter 4 it says, Hereby know ye the Spirit of God, every spirit that confesseth that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is of God, and every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God, and this is that spirit of Antichrist, wherever you have heard that it should come, and even now is already in the world. I was going to get you to turn to Ephesians chapter 2, but I think we're just going to hold off on that. And I just want you to know that in that passage, it just talks about the spirit. It talks about the prince of the power of the air. That's talking about Satan. And then there's a spirit that works in the children of disobedience. So the spirit of Antichrist is moving humanity in a certain direction. Okay? And so, but I wanted to talk to you a little bit about what the word, then ultimately there's going to be the one. And we're going to talk about him too in a second. The Antichrist. But real quick, I wanted to talk to you a little bit. I'm not going to even turn there. I just want to talk about it. About what Christ means. So the word Christ, let's just take this definite article away and let's just look at the word Christ. The word Christ literally means to, it comes from the word creo, if you were going to write it in English, or chrisma. And it talks about anointing. And it means to be smeared. To be smeared with oil. Alright? And it's the same word, the same exact meaning in the Hebrew is Messiah. It means to be smeared with oil. In 1 Samuel chapter 16, God tells Samuel, he says, how long will you mourn for Saul? Talking about King Saul. He had disobeyed God, right? God had placed Saul up as king. Saul disobeyed God. And I guess Samuel was walking around belly aching and complaining because Saul didn't do what he was supposed to do. God showed up and told Samuel, how long will you mourn Saul? Fill your horn with oil. Go down to Bethlehem and I want you to anoint me one of Jesse's boys. So Samuel goes down there with the horn of oil and he goes through all of them boys. Remember that? The story is a great story. We don't have, but I love that story. And all of a sudden there's nobody left. And they said, oh, but there's one more. Yeah, but he's out there in the field taking care of them sheep. You gotta get him. So they holler for him. I think that they blew the shofar, and all of a sudden it says that David shows up. He's a young boy. He's been tending the sheep, throwing his sling, right? And all of a sudden he shows up. He says he's beautiful in countenance and that he's ruddy-cheeked in appearance. And he shows up, probably all sweaty, taking care of the sheep. What's going on? Big old scene. The prophet's here. They're killing an animal. They're having a sacrifice in the little old town of Bethlehem. What's happening? Samuel says he's the one. Ooh. Samuel says he's the one, and he pours the oil on him. He anoints David as king. When you're anointed, then you are now being separated out, consecrated for a specific purpose. Whether it was to be king of Israel, or whether it was like the anointing oil that ran down Aaron's beard, amen? Which was to be anointed as high priest for God. And so what I want you to know is that that's what the word Messiah meant. Now when Jesus shows up on the scene, see, the word Christ in the Greek language means exactly the same thing. To be smeared with oil. To be smeared with oil, to be anointed. So whenever we talk about the Christ, what we're saying is that God has been talking about the fact that he's going to come for all of these years. He's been speaking it through the prophets. Daniel, remember that? He said Messiah. Until Messiah comes. Remember in the passage we read? The Messiah was promised that he would come. And all of these years. And now what the New Testament is saying is that Jesus was the manifestation of the Christ. Does that make sense? And so when Jesus shows up on the banks of the Jordan River, and John the Baptist says, there's one who comes before me whose sandal I'm not worthy to loosen. He will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and fire. And Jesus shows up and says, it's right for you to baptize me. And John the Baptist baptizes him, puts him in the water. It's like the whole process of being consecrated. And now when Jesus comes out the water, what happens? The heavens opened up. By the way, if you ever run into a United Pentecostal, this is a perfect scripture to talk to them about. They believe in a oneness theology, like there's not a Trinity. I had a talk with one the other day. I mean, is God a ventriloquist? That sounds bad, huh? Somebody was getting on me the other day. They said, dude, you are obnoxious and you need God to change your personality. All right, Lord, change me. But is he a ventriloquist? Because the heavens opened up and a voice spoke from heaven and said, this is my beloved son In him I am well pleased. Hear him. The Holy Spirit descended upon him like a dove. When they were smeared in the Old Testament, the Bible says of David, after he was smeared in the Old Testament with oil, that the Holy Spirit came upon him from that day moving forward. When Jesus went in the water, the heavens opened, the voice spoke, and the Holy Spirit descended upon him. Amen. The Holy Spirit was already in him. The Bible tells us that he was filled with the Holy Spirit while he was in his mother's womb. Amen. But now he was consecrated. Now he was anointed. Now he was ready to move forth in what God had always called him to be. Immediately after that, it says that he was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. He began to embark upon the journey of moving towards the cross, to die on the cross for your sin and for my sin. Then it says, if you want to turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 2. I'm sorry, 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 16. But I'm just going to tell you what happened in Matthew 17 as you turn to 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 16. All right? As you're turning to 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 16, I'm going to tell you what happened in Matthew chapter 17. Jesus took John, Andrew, and Peter. Amen? Is that right? Huh?
John, James.
John, James, and Peter. Thank you. Jesus took John, James, and Peter up on the mountain. That's why I was saying it slow. I was waiting for one of y'all to hit me, man, to get it right. We're on camera. James, John, and Peter. And he took them up on the mountain, and it's called the Mount of Transfiguration. And whenever the Bible says that he was transfigured before them, right? So what happened was glory shined out of him. Amen. And all of a sudden, they also see Elijah and Moses talking. And Peter says, oh, let us build three tabernacles, meaning tents, because he basically, we want to keep y'all three here, because this is wonderful. Look at all this glory that's going on in Jesus. And all of a sudden, that same voice spoke from heaven and said, this is my son. This is my beloved son. In him I am well pleased. Hear him. And then when they looked, Elijah and Moses was gone. The point was that no, he is the tabernacle. You understand? Jesus is the tabernacle in which the presence of God dwells. The presence of God came from heaven and came to earth. Peter didn't have a revelation of it. He didn't understand it. But right here in 2 Peter, I want you to see he has a revelation now. He has some understanding because he actually starts talking in verse 13. He says, yes, I think it meet or a good thing as long as I am in this tabernacle, talking about his physical body, to stir you up by putting you in remembrance, knowing that shortly I must put off this my tabernacle, even as our Lord Jesus Christ has showed me. In other words, I'm about to die. Moreover, I will endeavor that you may be able, after my decease, to have these things always in remembrance. I got to leave you with some stuff before I go. For we have not followed cunningly devised fables when we made known unto you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For he received from God the Father honor and glory when there came such a voice to him from the excellent glory. This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. And this voice which came from heaven we heard when we were with him in the holy mount. We have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto you do well that you take heed as unto a light that shines in a dark place until the day dawn and the day star arises in your heart. And so basically what Peter's telling them is, listen, I was on the mountain and I saw it with my own eyes. I need to tell you that there's a sure word of prophecy. If you'll believe me as a witness, I was standing there and I saw the glory of God come upon him and come out of him. And I'm here to tell you that if you'll hold on to this until, and I got it, we're about to shift gears a little bit, until the day star arises in your heart. Now, I made a choice that I wanted to go over this one more time about the day star. You see this word right here? Lucifer. I found out today, actually, in Latin, you don't pronounce it Lucifer. You pronounce it Lucifer. And it matters because I'm going to show you a video, and that's how they're going to pronounce it in the video, Lucifer. And so here I am. I can't just go based on what other people are telling me, so I had to go to Google Translate, stick it in there, flip it around, and hear how it says, and you say it in Latin, Lucifer, okay? So I wanted you to see that right here, see, what is the Latin Vulgate? And you may not remember this after I tell you this, but I just don't say nobody ever told you. The Latin Vulgate was one of the first translations. It was done by somebody named Jerome. And Jerome was in a cave. It was about AD 400. And he translated this for a pope. He took from the original Hebrew and the original Greek, and he made one translation into the Latin language. And this is what he chose to use for day star, talking about Jesus. When the day star shines in your heart, Lucifer, when Lucifer shines in your heart. Now, it wouldn't be that big of a deal because, see, the word Lucifer, it literally means light or light bearer. But what I want you to see what he did first was, if you go to Isaiah chapter 14, verse 12, what you see right here is that he uses the word Lucifer again. Isaiah 14, verse 12. Well, whenever you go to Isaiah 14, verse 12 in your English Bible that you can read, and you read it, it says, let's start at verse 11, thy pomp, meaning your pride, is brought down to the grave, and the noise of your vials, talking about stringed instruments, the worm is spread under thee, and the worms cover thee. How thou art fallen from heaven, Lucifer, son of the morning. This is talking about Satan. It's talking about Satan falling from heaven. Remember how Jesus said, I saw Satan fall from heaven to the earth. Amen. Like lightning. He fell to the earth like lightning. You cut down to the ground, which did weaken the nations. For you said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. You can come back. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Now, what is my main point? Why am I even doing this? Because I'm trying to make a point to you. And this is one of the first points. We're talking about the Antichrist. We're talking about the fact that there's been many Antichrists. We're talking about the fact that there's a spirit of Antichrist. This thing has been on the earth, moving and operating and manipulating in the midst of people's lives since the garden. And don't think that he hasn't been throwing himself in the midst of people since then. What I want you to do, I want you to just think for me for a second. Do you think that a man that's smart enough to translate from Hebrew to Latin and from Greek to Latin got in a cave? And when he got to the part that talks about an angel, he believes, that fell from heaven, and he names him Lucifer, that all of a sudden, about 6 months later, when he comes around to the Greek and is talking about Jesus, that he forgot that he called Satan Lucifer, and he accidentally applied the same name to Jesus? Because I'm not buying that. And I believe that this is a purposeful move, and we're going to take a look at something in a minute. But what I wanted you to see was, I wanted you to see that the terminology that's being spoken of in the day star for Lucifer is talking about Jesus, right? And that it's not talking about the Father. I want to make that point because when we get to the video, there can be no confusion now of what's being said in the video that I'm going to try to show you, all right? And so let's go back to 2 Peter chapter 1. Actually, let's go to 2 Thessalonians. Next week, I think we're going to actually break down this whole passage, but we're not going to get into that tonight. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 1. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 1. It says, we beseech you, brethren. Everybody there? 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 1. We beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by our gathering together unto Him. Now, I don't know about you, but that has the tone of a rapture to me. Because it's not just Jesus showing up, but it's us being gathered to Him. Okay? That you be not soon shaken in mind or troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter, as from us. See, somebody had sent a letter, he put Simon Paul's name to it, saying that the rapture had already taken place. as that day of Christ is at hand. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. Now, I don't want to talk about the falling away yet. We're going to talk about that next week. But what I do want to point out is this. The son of man, I'm sorry, not the son of man, Lord forgive me. That the man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, which means the son of sin or the son of lawlessness, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he is God, sits in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. So you see what he wants to do? He wants to elevate himself just like Lucifer, just like Satan in the Old Testament. I will ascend above the mount of God. I will sit myself above the temple of God. Amen. And the Lord ends up destroying him, causing him to fall, and he will be destroyed one day. But this man of sin, this is the manifestation. Remember, I told you that Jesus was manifest in the flesh. The Antichrist is going to be manifest in the flesh. There's many Antichrists. There's a spirit of Antichrist that's been moving through the ages, but there will be an Antichrist that will show up on the scene. He will be manifest in the flesh. He's a counterfeit Christ. He is going to deceive the masses. Somebody says,
"No, that's good."
Amen. And so it goes on to say, let's go down to verse 11. Well, let's look at verse 8 real quick. I'm sorry. And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. Look at verse 9. Even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders. Now when this guy shows up, he's going to have power. I mean, there's places where you're going to see fire coming out the sky. People are going to be getting healed. Don't think that Satan can't heal people. He put disease on people. He taking all the people. I mean, what did he do whenever he had a showdown with Moses? Right? All Pharaoh's magicians threw their staff down on the ground and they turned into snakes too.
Yeah.
The devil got some powerful magic. We've been calling him a toothless lion and he's been tearing people to shreds. We're in a war. And we better know how to hold on to the real Jesus, is all I'm trying to say. And he goes on to say in verse 11, this is the part that gets me. And for this cause, let's look at verse 10. And with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish. That's the world. This is the people that you talk to on a daily basis and try to tell them about Jesus and they don't want to hear about the Lord. And they finally just, at the end, they completely reject Jesus. And this is what they're going to be facing. It says, and receive not the love of the truth so that they might be saved. They refuse to receive the love of the truth. For this cause God shall send them strong delusion that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but have pleasure in unrighteousness. The Word of God tells us that there's coming a day whenever the man of sin is going to show up on the scene, and God allowed it to happen. Did you see that part? It said right there, verse 11, because they refuse to believe the truth, verse 11, for this cause God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie. I'm here to tell you tonight, church, and I fear this very thing is happening right now as we speak in churches in this community, in churches all around the land. The great falling away, the apostasia, is already taking place. Men behind pulpits, I'm not looking for a perfect man, I'm just looking for a man that will try to study the Word of God and present it for the way that it's written. Men behind pulpits are watering it down, changing it, and repackaging it and giving it to the people, and the people love it so. They're like a dog with an itch behind its ear, and how his leg kind of does like that because it feels so good. And he's heaped to themselves preachers because they have itchy ears and they want to hear something that's going to make them feel good. And in the end, they're going to wish that they didn't do that because they refuse to believe the truth. And because of that, God shall send them strong delusion that they might believe a lie. Lord, help us. Goes on to say in Revelation chapter 6, verse 2. I'll just read it to you real quick. Revelation 6, verse 2, it says, verse 1, I saw the Lamb opened one of the seals. So this is interesting to me. So the Lamb is opening the seal. You know who the Lamb is, right? That's Jesus. Jesus is the Lamb, and he's opening the first seal. This starts the whole thing off. See, I believe it like this. And I mean, if you can correct me, we can have a talk. And if I'm wrong, then we'll tell the people. I'm not ashamed of that. This is what's happening on earth. The Antichrist is signing a covenant with Israel on earth. And in heaven, the Lamb is opening the first seal. All right? And so what happens whenever the Lamb is opening the first seal, it says, I heard as it were the noise of thunder, one of the four beasts saying, come and see, verse 2, and I saw and behold a white horse. See, Jesus is coming back on a white horse in Revelation 19. This is the counterfeit Christ right here. Mm-hmm. People are going to think that he's the Messiah. Oh, we're about to get into this. We're about to close with it right here. And he that sat on him had a bow. No arrows, just a bow. So he's coming in peace, or so it looks. And a crown was given unto him, and he went forth conquering and to conquer. See, a crown was given to him. He looks like he's the anointed one. God allowed all this to happen. Jesus opened up the seal. He allowed strong delusion to be placed upon the earth because men refused to believe the truth. I want to turn with you. I want to turn real quick to Daniel chapter 8. Just bear with me. We might get out of here a little bit later.
No hurry.
Daniel chapter 8, verse 11 and 23. I'm still talking about this Antichrist. He's got a crown. He wants to go conquering. In 2 Thessalonians, it said that he was going to magnify himself. In Isaiah 14, he said that he was going to elevate himself above the throne of God. This is his whole purpose, to be elevated, to be magnified, to be worshipped. Okay? It says right here in verse 11, well, if you go up, oh, it's a lot of information, but if you go up to verse 8, it says, therefore the he-goat waxed very great, and when he was strong, the great horn was broken, for it came up four notable ones toward the four winds of heaven. Last week we learned that that was actually talking about Alexander the Great. You weren't here, right? That was the empire of Alexander the Great. He was the one-horned great one. And when he died, his kingdom was split into four generals. And one of them was called Antiochus Epiphanes. He was a first fulfillment of the Antichrist. But the ultimate Antichrist will do many things that Antiochus did. And we're going to talk about Antiochus again next week. And out of one of them came forth a little horn. That's talking about the Antichrist. Which waxed exceedingly great toward the south, toward the east, and toward the pleasant land. And it waxed great even to the host of heaven, and it cast down some of the host of the stars to the ground and stamped upon them. Verse 11, yes, he magnified itself even to the prince of the host, meaning he said, I am the prince of the host. And by him the daily sacrifice was taken away, and the place of the sanctuary was cast down. Verse 23, and in the latter time of their kingdom, when the transgressions are come to the full, a king of fierce countenance and understanding dark sentences shall stand up. Verse 25, and through his policy also shall he cause craft to prosper, and he shall magnify himself in his heart. I wanted you to see that he was going to magnify himself. Now you see what it says right there in verse 23. He understands dark sentences. While you're right there in Daniel chapter 8, let's turn backwards to Daniel chapter 5 real quick. And I want you to see something. In Daniel chapter 5 verse 11, this is what they're saying about Daniel in the kingdom of Babylon. Okay? It says, there is a man in your kingdom in whom is the spirit of the holy gods. Now you got to understand, these Babylonians don't know God. So they're worshiping false gods. And Daniel shows up and he's interpreting dreams and he's getting visions. And so this is how they explain it. Okay? And in the days of the father of thy father, light and understanding and wisdom, like the wisdom of the gods, was found in him. Whom the king Nebuchadnezzar, your father, the king, I say, your father, made master of the magicians, astrologers, Chaldeans, and soothsayers. For as much as an excellent spirit and knowledge and understanding, interpreting of dreams and showing of hard sentences and dissolving of doubts. The word dissolving of doubts describes untying knots, and hard sentences describes riddles. Daniel, through the Holy Spirit, was given revelation to dissect riddles, to dissect visions, to see dreams, to be able to see into the spiritual realm, and to be able to untie things that nobody else could untie. But what I want you to see, if you go back to Revelation chapter 8, it says right here in verse 23, in the latter time of their kingdom, when the transgressors are come to the full, a king of fierce countenance and understanding dark sentences. Same, it's the same wording, dark sentences. Alright? Dark sentences and heart and the other thing that I just said. But this is the thing. He is moving and operating under another spirit. So I believe he's speaking in riddles. He's speaking in a way of deception. The word in verse 25, if you go down to verse 25, it says, "And through his policy also shall cause craft to prosper." And the word policy means intelligence and understanding. The word craft means deceit and fraud. So I want you to see that the mouth, that this beast is going to be given a mouth. I didn't even go through the scriptures to show you that. You're just going to have to trust me because we're running out of time. The beast is going to be given a mouth. And he's going to speak. And he's going to speak with eloquence. But he's also going to have supernatural intelligence. And he's going to speak in a way that he speaks with riddles. You hear one thing out of his mouth, but what really is happening is that there's an underlying meaning that's taking place. And he's going to bring deceit, and he's going to bring fraud. Now, real quick, what I want you to what I want to do is I just want to read a little bit, a couple of things to you before I watch, show you this video. This guy right here, his name's Albert Pike. And he was a Confederate general. Yeah, you can turn it over there. He was a Confederate general. Now, you can see that he's a Mason. He's got his 33rd degree Mason thing. He's got the double-headed eagle here. He was a Luciferian. He wrote a book called Morals and Dogma. And if you can read in the book multiple quotes where he literally says Lucifer is God. Okay, so there's no question what this guy stood for. Supposedly, some letters were written by him to a guy in Italy named Mazzini during the World War, and they were both in the Masons together, and that these letters literally pre-planned three world wars. And it says in here, this is an excerpt from it, "The Third World War must be fomented by taking advantage of the differences caused by the Illuminati between the political Zionists," that's talking about the certain factions of Israel, "and the leaders of the Islamic world. The war must be conducted in such a way that Islam, the Muslim, Arabic world, and political Zionism, the state of Israel, mutually destroy each other. Meanwhile, the other nations, once more divided on this issue, will be constrained to fight to the point of complete physical, moral, spiritual, and economical exhaustion. We shall unleash the nihilists," that means people that don't believe in God, probably open up the prison doors, "wreak havoc and chaos on society, and the atheists, and we shall provoke a formidable social cataclysm, which in all its horror will show clearly to the nations the effect of absolute atheism, origin of savagery, and of the most bloody turmoil." They want atheism at this point to look bad. Alright? And this is why. "Then everywhere the citizens obliged to defend themselves against the world minority of revolutionaries will exterminate those destroyers of civilization and the multitude disillusioned with Christianity." So what he's saying is that if we cause chaos to fall on this land, most Christians, they're not ready for this. And they're going to be so disillusioned with Christianity that everything's going to fall apart. At least that's what they think. We know better than that, right? God holds this whole thing in his hands. Amen? He holds your life in his hands. God's not up there biting his fingernails. Amen? God's in control. I'm just telling you what these people's plans are. "Christianity, whose deistic spirits will from that moment be without compass or direction, anxious for an ideal but without knowing where to render its adoration, will receive the true light through the universal manifestation of the pure doctrine of Lucifer, brought finally out in the public view." Ultimately, I'm telling you, the plan of the Antichrist, he's just an incarnation of Satan himself. And the plan is that he's like a false Jesus that shows up, and he's going to perform miracles, and people are going to move towards this. Now, I want to tell you, this woman here is her name's Alice Bailey, and she looks like a pretty nice old girl, right? Kind of look like Betty Crocker. I mean, you wouldn't expect anything from her. She used to have. I'm not even going to tell you what the name of her publishing company was. All right, I'm going to read to you what she wrote. Then I'm going to tell you what the name of her publishing company was. Because as I read this to you, I want you to know the majority of Christians would think this is good. I bet you if you put it on Facebook, they'd like one. "From the point of light within the mind of God," right? The mind of God, that doesn't sound bad. "Let light stream forth into the minds of men. Let light descend on earth. From the point of love within the heart of God, let love stream forth into the hearts of men. May Christ return to the earth. Sounds pretty good, huh? Christ. Christ is his last name, right? From the center where the will of God is known, let purpose guide the little wills of men, the purpose which the masters know and serve. Who's the masters? I never heard that before in the Bible. From the center which we call the race of men, let the plan of love and light work out, and may it seal the door where evil dwells. Let light and love and power restore the plan of earth. As a matter of fact, I just rebuked all these words in the name of Jesus. Here's another one she wrote. Let there be peace on earth and let it begin with us. Let the forces of light bring illumination to mankind. Let the spirit of peace be spread abroad. May men of goodwill everywhere meet in the spirit of cooperation. Then she says this. She says, come forth, O mighty one. Let the souls of men awaken to the light, and may they stand with mast and tent. Let the fiat of the Lord go forth. The end of woe has come. Come forth, O mighty one. So if you don't know any better, she called him Christ. She talked about the mind of God and the, right? The name of her publishing company was Lucifer Publishing. Because see, what I need you to understand is that the word Christ isn't Jesus' last name. It's the title, the anointed one. The Bible says it's Jesus. He showed up lowly and riding on a donkey, but he's coming back one day on a white stallion. There's millions and millions upon multitudes that are engaged in the mystery religions. They believe that there's another Christ coming, and they're wanting him to come. With their free will, they're invoking him, and they're saying, come, mighty one, come back to the earth. And they're the most powerful people in the world. And they're behind the scenes, and they're doing and manipulating things that are taking place in governments across the world, taking place on music stages across the world, taking place in Hollywood movies across, in the cartoons that your children watch, going on and indoctrinating and brainwashing and preparing humanity to be blinded with this harlot's intoxication, and we walk around drunken with a spirit of intoxication. We can't even see anymore. We don't even really know who it is that what Jesus even looks like. This is what she says at the end, and I wanted to read this, and then we're going to watch this video. To those of you who can appropriate and use the great invocation, I would suggest its renewed and earnest use. This alternative invocation might, however, be suggested and found useful. O Lord of light and love, come forth and rule the world. The word Lucifer, means light bearer. These people believe that if they initiate or give themselves to him, their soul to him, just as in the garden, in the day that you eat thereof, you will not die. Instead, you will know, and you will become as gods. He's offered people this. We never saw that before. Nobody ever taught you that in the church because we never saw it. And it's there. And it's important that we understand it. There's two kingdoms coexisting upon the earth.
That's right.
And we're at war. And this is not a game that we're playing.
Amen.
Amen. And it says, O Lord of light and love, come forth and rule the world. May the Prince of Peace appear and the end of warring of the nations. May the reign of light and love and justice be begun. Listen to me. These people, with their free will that God gave them, are invoking the liar to come upon the earth and to take over this earth.
Amen.
And they're manipulating, and they're in the midst of circumstances that you and I don't even have clue about. And they're in unity. Thank you. All right, here we go. So what I want you to see is that this is actually the Vatican. Let me go ahead and break it down for you a little bit. This is the Vatican. This took place supposedly on an Easter Vigil Mass. I found that this psalm was sung more than once in the Vatican. And the word Lucifer is used. And I'm going to be honest with you. I believe personally, this is just me. I'm not claiming to be Daniel or one that figures out hard sentences. But I will tell you this. I don't believe what they think happened. They're trying to say the person that put this video out is exposing all of this. They say that what they're saying is that Jesus is Lucifer's son. That's not what he's saying. They don't understand the difference what the Christ means. What they're saying is that Lucifer's son is the Christ, because they're calling the Christ the Antichrist. You understand what I'm saying? But the people that put the video out, they think that what they're singing, because they use the word Christ, that they mean Jesus is Lucifer's son, but they missed it. That's not what's going on here. They're talking about the Antichrist coming forth from Lucifer. At least that's my interpretation. All right. So let's go ahead and see if we can get this thing started. All right.
qui licenzit divisus in partes, modo aditam et nobis decrementa annulari. Aditur enim di quantibus celis, quas in substantiam preciose voius laris, abismate reduxit. Overe beata nos, in pater eis celestia, humanis divina iuntum. Oramus ergo te, Domine, ut celebus iste in honorem tui nominis consecratus, ad noctis hujus caliginem destruendam, in deficiens te severe, et in odorem suavitatis acceptus, supernis luminaribus miceatur. Fraseius, Lucifer matuti, ille in quam Lucifer qui nescit optasum, Christus Sirius Mus.
So what I wanted you to see there is that, and I went to Google Translate to check for myself, the word Christus is the Christ, or Christ, right? Filius means son. And the reason that I had a feeling you were going to be here today, Irvin, was because I wanted to ask you what the pronoun for you in Spanish was, because it's the same pronoun basically that's in Latin, because I knew it was tu, right? T-U, is that correct? T-U in Spanish. And in this video, T-U-S, tus, your son, Christ, and belonging to Lucifer. But it's not talking about Jesus. It's talking about what they call Christ. What Alice Bailey said, come Lord of light, come. You understand what I'm trying to get at? And so what they're saying is that Lucifer is going to bring forth the what they call the Christ, which is Revelation chapter 6, verse 2. The first seal is opened. He's riding on a white horse. He has a bow without arrows. He's given a crown. And because the people refuse to believe the truth, they're going to be getting sent strong delusion. Now, if you can't see that we've already been sent some strong delusion, and that we've been confused about the way some things are happening upon the earth, then I think that we're having a hard time seeing. And some people might say, well, this isn't the place to do it. No, this is exactly the place to do it. For our eyes to be open.